So this talk is called This Mess We're In, and I think the plenary session did a great example of sort of explaining what that is. So I'm going to get into a little more detail. Because part of the work I do is done for a large corporate, I have a standard disclaimer which says that, you know, whatever I say is not their views and et cetera, et cetera. Because no one listens to thanks after they've been listening to someone for an hour, I wanted to thank people first. So this work that I'm going to talk about was not done in a vacuum. The people on the right are co-conspirators who I've actually all like co-authors of papers. And these are the foundations that I have like worked with while doing this, so I wanted to say thanks beforehand. My name is Morgan, and I'm a researcher at the Citizen Lab at the University of Toronto. This is a multidisciplinary think tanky sort of thing that focuses on the intersection of sort of global media, human rights, and digital security. For my day job, I do security engineering for a little known search engine. And I also do some volunteer work sometimes for the Electronic Frontier Foundation. I was thinking about what this talk is about. Like, so I've sort of done a bunch of research and I was going to talk about it. And then I was trying to think of this sort of narrative arc and like why I actually did this work. So I was thinking, well, you know, when I was younger, you know, I had a dream. And it was a little bit this sort of dream, but it actually turns out that it was really more of this sort of dream. You know, it was kind of a very 90s dream, and it's actually kind of an admission, right? Like, so I was a teenage techno-utopian, right? I was like, oh my god, the internet is like totally fantastic. This whole unprecedented ability to communicate with people all over the world is fantastic. It's going to change humanity and solve all our problems. We'll end war and global hunger. It's going to be great. And I thought that we were going to win because I thought that intrinsically information operated in certain ways. And, you know, we sort of saw the internet give voice to those who previously hadn't had any. Now, as it turns out, you know, I grew up in sort of the internet, and technology doesn't solve asymmetrical problems. It acts as a power amplifier. So that means that we kind of got the first few years of the internet for free. You know, the early adopters, you know, people sort of go on message boards and were like, wow, look at us, we can communicate, that sort of thing. And then other people sort of really thoroughly got on top of the internet. And so when people that had sort of had genuine power got hold of it, that meant that power was also amplified. So in case anyone is not aware, and I'm actually presuming that everyone in this audience will be, this is a picture of a prison that was designed by Jeremy Bentham. And the idea was that someone, you had the central room from which you could see all the cells, and it would disincentivize the prisoners from misbehaving. Because they wouldn't actually know if they were being watched or not, but, you know, there could be someone in that central room watching them, so they should probably, you know. Which obviously is, you know, I'm using this as a metaphor for the problems with global internet surveillance. So this talk is actually about surveillance. I'm going to talk about the problems of mass surveillance. I'm going to talk about a bunch of the mechanisms of targeted surveillance, which frequently people actually think of as hacking. And I'm going to talk a little bit about legal coercion, because that actually kind of plays an important part of this whole game. So I presume most of the people in this room are reasonably familiar with the mechanisms by which mass surveillance actually happens. Very, very briefly, generally what you do is you just stick boxes which intercept traffic at really fat junction points on the internet, and you can sort of hoover it up or gather, you know, data, metadata, you know, artisanal data, big data, small data, yeah, that sort of thing. And there's sort of a bunch of companies that sell hardware which, you know, facilitates this type of collection. A lot of you guys have probably heard of NARIS. If you're not sure why you've heard of NARIS, it's because there's a guy called Mark Klein from San Francisco, who was one of the first NSA whistleblowers. He was an AT&T technician whose job was to run fiber, and so he was running, they asked him to run a whole bunch of fiber into this room, which was full of NARIS boxes, which did massive intercept for the NSA. And he decided that he wasn't totally cool with this, so he told the public about it. Now, you've probably seen this picture before, right? So XKeyStore is, according to what's been made public, theoretically one of the NSA's more wide-ranging intercept platforms. And so this gives you people's internet browsing history and, you know, all sorts of information that passes, you know, over the internet about people. And as you can see from this wonderful slide that's been created. You know, their reach is fairly broad, as you would expect from the best funded spy agency in the world. Now, Naris is not the only provider who provides this sort of thing. The blood here is actually not, this is not the company's actual logo. The blood was also not added by me. I found this editorialization on the internet while I was actually looking for this company. And I was like, this is amazing. And the Amesis are actually also a massive industry vendor. And the reason why the blood is because their gear was found in Libya. And now, a bunch of people were really unimpressed by that because, I mean, without going too much into it, it was sort of widely felt that Gaddafi and his friends ran the country like a bunch of thugs. And so facilitating a surveillance state was not viewed as very human rights friendly. Bluecoat is actually probably another company that you've all heard of. And these guys sell genuinely dual-use technology. They sell boxes which provide real-time monitoring of your network, which if you're a large enterprise, sounds like a great idea. In fact, it's advised. You should probably do this. The reason why, you know, there was sort of some controversy around them is because in 2011, the hacktivist group Telecomics discovered that their gear was being used in Syria. And there's going to be talks about sanctions and export controls and all sorts of things, but Syria is one of those countries that the US vendors are simply just not allowed to sell to. So there was a Wall Street Journal article, and this was a big deal. And then I remember shortly after that hearing about the fact that Bluecoat devices were allegedly being used in Saudi Arabia to facilitate largely internet censorship there. And I thought about this, and I sort of wondered why we were getting excited about finding this in one country or another country. And because I'm a security engineer, I decided to plot things and make a map. So this was a map that was made, I think it's beginning of 2013. And it's a little unclear, so I'm going to explain the colors. So the blue is sort of where I found, you know, these Bluecoat boxes. The black is where I did not find these Bluecoat boxes. And the gray is where I found them but decided I didn't care. Now, the reason why I decided I didn't care is because these were places where I found them, but I found them on corporate networks. And so it's like, if you're using it on a corporate network, I actually just don't, you know. But in the other places, they were found on public networks and provider networks. And what's actually interesting is that, you know, Bluecoat now sells a service that they describe as SSL visibility, which is very worrying. And what that is they use sort of very high-speed network processes to look at traffic in a large quantity, and if you, for some legitimate reason, have, you know, a root certificate, then an SSL is configured in a certain way. And there's a bunch of providers, but the long and short of it is that, you know, these boxes are supposed to help you inspect encrypted traffic. So we reported on this January 16th. What was nice was in April 2013, it was actually found that their resale, their gear was actually being sold through a reseller, I think in Dubai. And their reseller was fined for sort of unethical business practices. And I thought that was it. But then this thing happened called the Internet Census, which I'm not, do people in the room know what that was? The Internet Census was this crazy bit of rogue academia where this guy actually wrote a botnet, infected hundreds of thousands of computers around the world, and what he did with it is he used it to make a map of the internet. And this is the most complete map of the internet that we've actually seen. I was able to see inside networks by looking at his scans that I, you know, couldn't see from my vantage point. And sort of like, as opposed to sort of an aerial shot of a map of the city, it's like someone walked through all the buildings. So maybe another map. And what was interesting this time, particularly pertinent, is, you know, we sort of ended up with these devices showing up in Iran, which is another country that US vendors are simply just not allowed to sell to. So Bluecoat is found in Saudi Arabia. Now, we released another report on this, and the investigation is ongoing. As I said, the technology is genuinely dual use, but what I found interesting about this is that Bluecoat's president said, we do not design our products for surveillance or, you know, the purpose of suppressing human rights. It's fine. But if they don't design their products for surveillance, then why have they been sold for surveillance? And I was sure that they had, But when I actually went to look for it, I started finding things like this. So they published an apology about their devices being found in Syria. And oddly, that was gone when I last looked for it. It had been 404. And then I was looking, trying to find evidence of them advertising this gear, surveillance gear at conferences. And also, the links I found in them were also gone. Fortunately, the Wayback Machine remembers. And so you have Craig Hicks Fraser, VP Blue Coat Systems, selling at ISS World in Dubai 2006, which is a surveillance fear, practical examples of lawful intercept. So, you know, go figure. Anyway, this actually shouldn't, I mean, basically what this shows is sort of heavy proliferation of these types of technologies, which is probably not a new concern to anyone in this room. In fact, generally not the sort of internet community. In fact, there was sort of a group of people in the 90s, you know, cypherpunks were very, very concerned about the threats that mass surveillance might play to free expression on the internet. And they wrote a bunch of tools. And as a thought exercise, if you imagine being a cypherpunk in the 90s and waking up right now, you might actually think that you'd won that fight. Because the world's most popular operating system vendor has full disk encryption. A bunch of large web providers all do HTTPS by default. The Tor project still exists, and people use it, and it's actually like been influential in world events, just crazy. Whisper systems, people doing encrypted text, encrypted voice, you know, this is fantastic. However, as we all know, surveillance has changed a lot too. And it's also now child-friendly. But there was a fantastic article in Foreign Policy magazine a little while ago that detailed a group in the NSA called the TAO, or Tailored Access Operations. And what was interesting is it stipulated that much of the code breaking that is done now is not actually done by NSA's football field mathematicians, but what happens is that you actually get a group of people to break into systems, steal keys, and then decrypt traffic and so forth, because it's simply much cheaper and easier. Obviously, the NSA is not the only people doing this. The activities of 3PLA, the Chinese equivalent, have been reasonably well documented in terms of breaking into computers to steal materials, etc., etc. And this happens much like you would expect. Target gets exploited, an implant gets inserted onto their computer or digital device, and then you surveil their communications, track their location, or steal data, or you know, whatever there is you think you might do. And this is a really big deal. Even to the point where Microsoft's general counsel, Brad Smith, said, "Government snooping potentially now constitutes an advanced persistent threat." And this was sort of in the Microsoft blog post about when the NSA revelations came out. This sort of thing has been going on for quite a while. For people with a certain eye, you might remember this one, which is the Bundestrojaner. So this was a case where it actually came out of a legal discovery. The defendant was a steroid dealer. And what happened was, is in legal discovery, it was revealed that the German police had backdoored his computer to collect his communications about the steroid ring. And so the defense asked for his computer back. And forensics was done, and you know, the police's backdoor was sort of analyzed and found they were doing it. Around a similar time, the Dutch government was proposing very interesting laws, suggesting that they be allowed to conduct remote searches on computers anywhere and be able to delete data on remote computers anywhere to remove the accessibility of illegal files, which of course is super worrying, right? Because now all of a sudden it's like, wait, can I hack my computer just to delete my MP3s? Like this law didn't pass in this form. But what it shows actually a demand, right, for this type of technology, for this type of surveillance. And demand leads to supply in a free market world. So the types of technologies you get facilitating targeted surveillance, there's a lot of different terminology, and you sort of get like malware used and exploits and this sort of thing, and it gets tossed around, which can be very confusing. So I like to make a joke that malware is any software that gets installed on your computer without an end user license agreement. Which is, but there's all sorts of sort of names that they get used for it. And I think the issue, right, is that when you sort of think of this type of stuff as In the same way as you would like sort of when you actually got a computer virus in the 90s. And that was kind of like a drag, because you might have to spend a couple of days, you know, reformatting your computer or something like that. The sale of this type of technology isn't new. What we've got on the left-hand side is, you know, like, there's a bunch of big arms manufacturers, Raytheon, Harris, Mantec, Northrop Grumman, that have been sort of producing exploits for a while. And, you know, these days there's kind of more boutique, smaller players. Now, what's interesting actually is, on the regulation side, I heard a very interesting interview with one of the smaller players recently where he said, if you regulate it, you're never going to stop large US arms manufacturers generating exploits. What you're going to do is you're going to put us out of business, the sort of the small guy. Now what we've got here is this is a two-year-old price list for exploits. This got leaked on the internet. And it sort of shows how much it costs for exploits and, you know, anything from Adobe Reader around $30,000, Word $100,000, you know, Chrome Internet Explorer up to $200,000, etc. So there's been a lot of hot debate on the subject of producing this type of technology. What I found interesting about this statement was that it was actually on Daily Dave mailing list. Now, Daily Dave is a mailing list that is run by a guy named Dave Itella. That's why it's called Daily Dave. And there was sort of a long discussion between people that actually produced exploits about the ethical nature of this business. And what this guy actually said is, what exactly do you think they do with the intel they collect from such operations? I just don't buy the hate the game, not the player argument here. If you sell someone an exploit that in turn ends up used to exfil intel, that in turn ends up in an extraordinary rendition, or a car bomb strapped to the side of a scientist's car, your hands are anything but bloodless, and you have most certainly deployed bombs and guns, unlike you speculate. But whatever, that's life, and we're all spooks now. So, how does this play out in the really real world? Well, this woman is an activist for Bahrain Watch, her name is Alasha Habib, and she lives in London. Now, a couple of years ago, she was, who says end-user education doesn't work? A non-technical person, right? She's like, I think I've been hit by a targeted Trojan. Which, go her, she was right. Now, I ended up helping do the analysis on this Trojan that targeted her. Now, it turned out that this was a Trojan called Finfisher, which is commercially produced by a company in Munich and resold by a company called Gamma International in London. And it came to some attention during the Arab Revolution in Egypt when protesters broke down the doors of the state intelligence establishment and ransacked documents they found within, and they actually found these. Now, as you can see, there's two state security investigation department, Cairo, Egypt, remote intrusion solution, FinSpy, you know, cost $287,000. Euros. Which sounds expensive, but is actually really not, right? Like, if you're a dictator, this is the sort of change you find in, you know, pockets of your robe or whatever. At least in my head, I imagine. I've never been a dictator, nor do I know any, but, you know. So, people really want to know what this backdoor looks like. Right, like Mikko Hyvönen, who runs an antivirus company out of Finland, Livsecure, said, we know it exists, but we've never seen it. You can imagine a rare diamond. So it was interesting actually finding this and analyzing it. And this isn't, you know, sort of a virus. This is a fully featured surveillance solution. So the great thing is that due to leaked materials about this, you know, we could actually, we know what it does because they advertised it. So I can do all sorts of things that you might imagine, which is, you know, recording your keystrokes, files you transfer, Skype conversations, you know, but I mean, what a lot of people have found creepy is the ability to record ambient sound via your computer's microphone or turn on your laptop's camera. What actually, so I ended up analyzing not just one, but a whole bunch of their backdoors because as I mentioned, as a total surveillance solution, this works on a variety of things, right? They sell versions for iPhone, Android, BlackBerry, Symbian, Windows Mobile. So what this provides is obviously you can location track someone, you know, you can watch them wander around, you can listen to their phone calls, intercept their SMSs, steal their contacts. What actually I found incredibly creepy when I was doing analysis on this was a function that was actually called spy call in the code when you decompile it. And what happens is that when the backdoor is instantiated, it takes control of the hardware, so no ringing, no vibrating, no buzzing, no lights go on, and it just instantiates this outbound call. And so someone is just listening all the time. I mean, you carry this everywhere, right? And then if the incoming call comes in, it returns control to the phone, buzzing, flashing lights, ringing, etc., etc. Your phone call gets made, and then when you stop your call, the outbound call gets instantiated again. And that actually ended up with me doing a lot of. So anyway, maps. So we made a map. What we did is we did a bunch of scanning to find where we could find remote control. The command and control servers that are used to control the implants that you infect victims with. And we found these at sort of a bunch of interesting places all over the world. Some of them, for instance, like the Canada, United States. I mean, there's a lot of boxes on Amazon's cloud, on Rackspace's cloud. It's not definite evidence that it's being used by the US government or anything like that. There were other places, however, like Turkmenistan, where the command and control server was found to be in a range owned by the Turkmenistan Ministry of Information, which seemed a little suspicious to me. Now, I mean, Turkmen is a pretty freedomy country. I think recently in a survey, which showed that 99% of the population was deliriously happy, and that the president had declared an era of supreme happiness. So, I mean, they probably don't even need these sorts of tools. Now we released this report in sort of July 2012, and it got quite a lot of attention. And what was actually useful is that a group of people that are actually far crazier than hackers started to dive into this, and this is investigative reporters. And they discovered all sorts of weird things about this company. I don't actually fully understand the business side of things, but it was discovered that they had offshore accounts in the Cayman Islands, and their business practices were strange, at least in a way that was very interesting to people that actually understand this. And the British government was actually like, yeah, I'm not entirely sure about this. You should probably not be allowed to sell this stuff to repressive regimes. Now, I also don't know exactly what constitutes a repressive regime, but I think it's probably good that the government, you know, suggested that the sale of this not be allowed. The sort of latest moves on this, there's an Ethiopian guy in the UK that discovered that the Ethiopian government was using this technology to spy on him, and he is not very happy. So he's asked for the British government to investigate. Closer to home here in the US, there is another Ethiopian who had also found this technology was used to target him, and with the help of the EFF, they are attempting to sue the Ethiopian government for damages and spying on a US citizen. So what this actually speaks to is this sort of example of a commercialized threat landscape. I mean, there, as I mentioned before, cellular offensive technology isn't new, but it actually used to be something that was created by people that had boutique capability, right? So you had countries that had been making their own technology, obviously sort of Five Eyes in Russia and, you know, that sort of thing. But what this is you actually see the rise of a third-party surveillance industry selling this technology to whomever. This is kind of a famous conference because it's known as the Wiretaps Ball, and it's sort of held around the world. ISS World, Intelligence Support Systems for Lawful Intercept Criminal Investigations and Intelligence Gathering. And so you can go there and buy like a bunch of interesting stuff. There's sort of a bunch of products that they sell, and I'm going to sort of describe another one at the moment as an example of where this sort of hits the real world. This is a guy named Ahmed Mansour, he was one of the UAE Five. Now, he was imprisoned for signing a pro-democracy petition, and he was let out. And then after his release, he found that he was being tailed, and he was occasionally assaulted when he was standing up in public and giving talks about, you know, democracy in the UAE, which is a fraught subject. And he wasn't sure how they were actually tracking him. Now, he was actually quite a smart guy, and he was a heavy Tor user. So what he actually noticed was that he was seeing logins to his mail account from inside the Emirates, which never happened because he always used Tor. And so it became very suspicious. And so I ended up actually helping him with the analysis of his computer, which proved to have been backdoored by a product called, now it's been called Remote Control System. It's also been called Da Vinci, and it's now called Galileo. So they're having a bit of an identity crisis with the branding, but it remains the hacking suite for governmental interception. Now, this is sold by, I said, a company called Hacking Team out of Milan, and they claim their backdoor is stealth and untraceable, immune to protection systems, hidden collection infrastructure, and basically the idea is that this is going to provide a government actor with remote monitoring for a security-aware, geographically mobile target, which is sort of basically anyone that's not in country and kind of understands a little bit about like using encrypted services, or possibly even just uses like Hotmail or you know something that's now encrypted, right? So the report came out in 2012, and I think Hacking Team denied that they sell their products to any governments that are, disreputable. However, their product was also found being used to target citizen journalists in Morocco. This is a group called Manfrekinch. They said a variety of things that the Moroccan government didn't particularly like during sort of uprisings in the Middle East. And their organization, they won a free expression online award from Global Voices, and I think Google gave them a bunch of money for this sort of thing. And they actually, being a citizen journalist organization, they received a message which wasn't exactly designed to congratulate them. And they sort of have this, you know, portion of their webpage which says, please send scoops here. And so they got a message which said, well, I really don't want to be named, but this is really scandalous. You should really download and look at this doc. which, as it turns out, was actually also Hacking Team's technology. And so this has actually been used rather liberally. And we sort of did some recent mapping efforts. Now, they actually have a mailing list. You can just go to their webpage and sign up for Hacking Team's mailing list. And recently, the guy from Hacking Team said, I think he said, we, you know, like 30 plus countries was, I think, his quote. So we tried to make a map. It's going to be yellow for the rest of the time. So we tried to make a map of countries that we could actually, couldn't get all 30, but you know, no one's perfect. This was sort of a map of countries which we, you know, sort of heavily suspect that the governments are actually using this technology. So interestingly, sort of, you know, places like Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Saudi Arabia, Iran, UAE, etc. Now, what gets interesting, really, really interesting, is when this technology is used in sort of a hot war zone. So, as you guys are probably aware, Syria's been in some turmoil for, you know, 3 years or so. Now, sort of around, I think it was actually Valentine's Day in 2012, CNN produced this article saying that spyware was the newest weapon in the Syrian conflict and that sort of thing. Now, the guy's face that you can see here is a man named Burhan Galyun, and he was, at the time, the head of the Syrian Transnational Opposition. Now, his Facebook page was compromised, and it was actually used to seed malware to all of the people that were actually sort of in close contact with him. Now, I ended up investigating this, and this is actually going to seem humorous, and we'll get to the slightly grimmer stuff in a second, but I actually found the website that the people who did the attacks used for staging. So they actually went through various iterations of their actual phishing campaign. So this was one of them. And as anyone who's ever used Facebook can tell, this is not very representative of a Facebook page. They also tried. So this was actually the website that I found, and they had directory listing turned on, so I could look at the various, you know, attempts that they used to make this phishing thing, right? And this was another one they tried. Also not incredibly Facebooky. And this one, which, you know, not so Facebooky either. And this kind of seems amusing. I sort of wanted to sort of show some, you know, details about how this investigation went. But a lot of the targeting is actually incredibly grisly. It it generally suggests that people should view or look at content that pertains to atrocities committed by soldiers, rape of women in towns by Assad's thugs, and that sort of thing. And what this does is it sort of provides visibility into communications of the opposition, where the consequences can actually be pretty total. So recently I was analyzing malware that was used in Syria, and it said, you know, witness this atrocity by a Syrian soldier as he murders the civilian. And so I was analyzing malware. So I pulled it apart and I separated the implant and I was like, oh, this video is now clean. And without thinking about it, I actually watched it. Now I've seen a lot, which was, yeah, chump move. So I'd seen a lot of really grim stuff on the internet, but I'd usually been reasonably steeled for it. Whereas in this case, I was actually just sort of sitting there working away. And it was a video of this guy having his throat cut and being pushed into a shallow grave to bleed out, which was probably one of the sort of more disturbing days of doing this type of work that I've had from sitting in an office in San Francisco. So this is actually a very real game. The targets are pretty well studied, and the people that train them, which is some of the people in this room, are actually pretty well studied too. How this training carried out, and it's in fact used, again, to target people. So this is a tool that's a Persian language only circumvention tool to be used by people in Iran. One of these is a real installer. One of these, if installed, will actually send all of your communications to Saudi Arabia. This is a tool called Freegate. This was found in Syria. You actually get a real copy of Freegate. You also just get a free SVC host binary, which sits in your application data folder, which sends your malware to some, which sends your information to somewhere in Damascus, which you probably don't want. I've even seen backdoor copies of the Tor browser bundle. The copy that I actually analyzed most recently sent information somewhere in China, which I guess is sort of unsurprising given the Chinese government's sort of targeting groups like Falun Gong and that sort of thing. What gets very scary, I think, about this game is that we've seen targeting not only of people, sort of direct persons of interest, but actually even people that have actually written about issues. So recently I wrote up an analysis of a bunch of malware that was used by Vietnamese actors. Now, what they'd actually been doing is they've been hacking, there's a massive Vietnamese diaspora, it's like 8 million people. And they've been targeting people, Vietnamese people in America, Vietnamese people in France, and this was generally people that wrote political blogs. Now, where things got really wacky is the same actors actually targeted the EFF. And they targeted the two people at EFF that have written about Vietnam. Now, they targeted the person who usually writes about Vietnam, and once when she was busy, she had an intern write about Vietnam, and they targeted the intern as well. Additionally, an Associated Press reporter who walks the Vietnam beat, also targeted by these guys. It actually just sort of goes to show this sort of technology is very scalable and it's very deniable, which makes it very attractive to use. What are the side effects? Government surveillance is depressing and scary. I've been talking about it for a while, so I thought I'd just cheerful bunch of kittens. The talk doesn't get any cheerier after this either. There's no kittens at the end, so. This actually brings us to an interesting place, because obviously if you're the right person in the right location that has the right sort of power, you don't actually have to do this. You can just ask for stuff. Right? Now, I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with the dystopian comic Judge Dredd, but there's actually been a lot of really interesting, I think, interpretations of the law, and I'm not a legal person, but it seems like there's sort of been a lot of dispute over the sort of legitimacy of a lot of the requests that are going around, because what's been very worrying to me as an engineer is that we've been seeing not just government requests, warrants, NSLs, FISA, for just data, we've seen legal demands to either alter systems or provide crypto keys which would give access to massive amounts of user data. Anyone in this room who's a Microsoft user probably knows what BitLocker is. It's Microsoft's full disk encryption product. Now, the head of BitLocker engineering actually said that he was approached by the FBI and asked multiple times to add a backdoor to BitLocker. So I mean, this is like a request to actually alter the largest operating system in the world to make it easier for them to access encrypted data. You guys are almost definitely all aware of this one, LavaBit, where it's Edward Snowden's mail provider. So the legal request that was sent to them was actually for their key materials, because they offered, you know, encrypted email. And of course, these key materials were turned over, it actually meant that, you know, the government would actually be able to read all of LavaBit's users. Now, that was sort of a peculiarity of how they'd set up crypto, but I mean, it is sort of concerning that the requests are coming in not just for data, but for key materials and operating systems and that sort of thing. There's a variety of legal battles going on with this. The EFF has been suing the NSA for a really long time. And there's also been sort of a bunch of letters from people in the security community and various academics and that sort of thing. And there was, an NSA review committee that has made recommendations which the government's ignoring, all that sort of good stuff. So as an engineer, now I don't actually think that crypto will save you, but it actually, we can do some very useful things with it. So I think that we need to start engineering in a coercion-resistant manner. And the reason why I say this is because I postulate this axiom, which is as your web service increases in popularity, the likelihood that you will eventually be forced to coerce your security model approaches, well, definite, right? Now, as I was sort of coming up with this, I thought, maybe this is going to be a hard sell. And then this came out, right? Like, world of spycraft, NSA and CIA spied in online games. Really? And this is actually a 70-page unredacted document on this, which makes for fascinating reading, because it's actually largely about the fact that the GCHQ had developed a lot of in-game spying capability. And the NSA was like, we really got to get in on this. This is thoroughly good, right? Like, they've already had an effort to exploit gaming in virtual environments. They had exploitation models at Xbox Live, World of Warcraft. You know, it was like, come on, guys. You know, we're not getting these sweet gaming chats. And so I was like, I think it's a fairly safe postulation that if you have massive amounts of user data, you know, someone is actually going to try to coerce you to give it up at some point. Now, there's sort of a variety of interesting things that people have done with cryptography historically. Now, you occasionally would sound like that crazy crypto guy when you talked about this sort of thing, which is not actually a particularly reliable position. Like, people don't always think that, you know, a lot of the things suggested are very reasonable. One of the things that I want to point out is that some of the core parts of the internet have actually been engineered in a coercion-resistant way. For instance, DNSSEC is a great example. They have a key split between seven people that's actually held in seven different countries, simply because they knew that this was important and they didn't want single individuals to be able to be coerced in order to actually monkey with the DNS system that runs the internet. Now, DNSSEC has a bunch of other problems, but I sort of want to show that this is actually, you know, mainstream engineering now. There's a bunch of things that could be done. I'm actually not going to go into the details too much because we were running a bit late. But the idea behind this, now if you remember the mid to late 90s, there was a big push from the Net Freedom community that, you know, like really beat up on large providers to provide HTTPS logins everywhere. And you know, Google did it, Facebook did it, Twitter did it, and then there was much rejoicing, and everyone was like, yeah, we encrypted the web, woo! And there was sort of, you know, much rejoicing, and we celebrated a little bit too soon. And I'm not actually talking about this, which if you were actually on deck that day, felt a little bit like this. But what people don't actually understand about Google's environment is the HODL ACPAR RPC. It's as complicated, but... what I'm actually talking about is this, right? Now this is a diagram that probably a lot of people are super familiar with, right? You know, Alice talks to Bob, and Eve is the eavesdropper, right? Now what actually happened when we like encrypted the web is that we encrypted to provider cloud one, and then mail gets sent to another provider in the clear. And then Bob logs into other provider over encrypted medium and reads the email. So, and when all this stuff sort of came out about Prism and so forth, you know, I ended up thinking, it's like, well, actually, if you have this massive intercept capability, then all of this email, which is sort of really the juice of people's communications, that's actually what you want to see, that's all just traveling around for free anyway, right? Like, you don't even need to coerce providers or get them to give up keys or hack into people's computers. If you actually control this monitoring domain and there's clear text email flying around, you just get people's communications for free. So there is something called start TLS, which provides sort of opportunistic encryption. That means that users don't actually have to understand anything about crypto. What actually happens is that mail server here will talk to a remote mail server and say, hey, will you encrypt this traffic? And the remote end will be like, yeah, okay. And then all of a sudden, you know, we actually have encrypted traffic and it's transparent to the end users, and you actually sort of solve this problem of all this massive clear text email flying around. Now, I looked at the 20 most popular domains in my mailbox right after the Snowden regulations came out. And irritatingly, only 5 of them actually did this. And unfortunately, only 2 of them actually did it properly. So I was a little bit like, and the last time I looked was sort of November last year. And we've actually started to see an upswing in this, but this would actually be like a seriously good thing TM in terms of reducing the amount of bulk data that's just flying around in the clear. Now, according to a recent estimate, there's well over 1 billion users for, say, Hotmail, Windows, Live, and Gmail. So what I think would be a great idea for some large providers is if everyone ran start TLS. I think that would be fantastic. The good thing is that it's doable. We already have the technology. People have engineers. You can turn it on. That's great. The bad thing is that it's opportunistic encryption. So that actually means that you can actually still perform attacks on it. Like, you know, Alice logs into provider, sends email. Eve here says, do you provide encryption? No! But, oh, well, here's the email anyway, right? Not so great. Well, what would be better in the long term is if we had this technology and we actually had pinning of the cryptographic properties between major providers. Because those servers aren't going anywhere. People actually know what their key materials are, and if large companies actually share their key materials and agree to only recognize each other's, then this traffic would be undeceptable and would provide sort of real protection for around 1 billion users, and I think that would actually be pretty cool. So the idea is that I think, basically though, I mean, that's sort of just an example, but I think that as you know, I'm an engineer, so I think that engineering really needs to happen now to protect against the coercion of a security model. And it's something we actually have to do in order to protect users. Like, to not do so is actually negligent. Now, I think we have the tools, and I think that we can do this. Going back to the beginning, like, maybe I'm kind of, you know, as I said, my admission of being a teenage techno-utopian. And so I think it's sort of like really difficult to admit that you might have been wrong when you're a teenager. And so I still sort of think that, you know, as Marie just said before, the NSA's actions have made internet freedom a really difficult, legitimate foreign policy goal. However, I actually think that there are things that we can do. While crypto won't save us, this is sort of, as an engineer, I think, in terms of engineering, but my fight doesn't have to be your fight, which is sort of why we're actually all at RightsCon. There's a lot of different types of skills that everyone has. And so I think the idea is actually just not to be privacy or security nihilists. So that's actually basically sort of what I wanted to end on. I think that there's actually lots of ways that we can sort of try to dig ourselves out of this mess. I'm now happy to answer any questions. So I think we're probably
about 15 minutes left.
Right. Okay, that's great. So this is a sample question. This is actually what I frequently get, which is, I realize that I was a victim of tiny malware attack. Please take a look. The answer is not right now. But you know, if anyone else has any other questions, then I'm happy
Who are the two good email providers? Who are the two good email providers with the start TLS and everything?
The live stream. So Google actually has it set up properly, and so does gmx.de, who's a German provider, and I looked and I was like, well, hey, this is great. That was in June last year. Like, people have actually really upped their games. There's actually, I think, I can't remember who it was. It was something really surprising recently. I think it was like Comcast or Verizon that actually had their stuff set up properly, or I mean, it was someone. He's shaking his head no. But it was. I can't remember who it was, but it was someone that I was like, well, I wouldn't have thought that. But I said we can talk afterwards. I can show you and try to figure out an updated list or something. Anyone else?
What about staff at rest? How do you deal with to cope with not having to answer?
Well, I think
with the data in the
sort of data at rest. So I mean, there's sort of a broad question, right? So there's lots of things that you can do, right? Like you can require that things be held in an encrypted manner. I mean, I think Mailpile is trying to do something where, you know, the problem with this, right, is that there's a massive trade-off in usability. If only the user can access their data with a password, it means if they forget that, then it's gone, which is actually something that freaks out a lot of people, right? And so, I mean, there's sort of a bunch of, you can start doing really interesting things. Like if you want to sort of go down the crypto mine, you could actually store data in such a way that it requires really complex and expensive computations to decrypt, which means that you could, you know, maybe decrypt, say, one user's worth of data, but if someone asks for 10,000, then it would take a really long time. But I mean, I guess it sort of depends on exactly what problem you're trying to solve for how much data and who your users are, right? So there's, you know. Anyone else?
I have a question that this is kind of odd, and I'm asking you to respond to something that's not really sort of on you, but I'm curious, you know, there would be all these hacker conferences, right? And then the NSA would go and they would try to recruit them. I mean, they were out very actively, and they still are, right?
Yeah.
And then, you know, presumably they were successful sometimes, and now everybody's shocked that the NSA is using hacking techniques.
No.
They're actually hacking into things. Well, I mean,
I'm also
do they think they would get
this.
Cured when they would start working
no.
for the
NSA? No, I think this is actually a really interesting question because I mean, one of the things that I've always found interesting is the sort of the internal narratives of communities and that sort of thing. And I find it very interesting that General Hayden actually bothers to show up to conferences like Black Hat and DEF CON to lie to the security community. Because obviously he cares what their opinion is. Otherwise he wouldn't take the time to lie in person. But I mean, I think that sort of, we're still sort of in an interesting area. I liked what Jeff Moss wrote. So Jeff Moss is the CEO, founder, whatever, of DEF CON, which is sort of one of the largest hacker conferences in the world. And he actually wrote a blog post after these things, which was called Feds, I Think We Need Some Time Apart. He actually asked the intelligence and law enforcement community not to come to DEF CON. Which, I mean, as I said, I'm not entirely sure how the community narrative plays out, but I think there's not so much of a blanket trust anymore. There's sort of a like, you know, we really need to think about where we are.
No, I have two questions. Mm-hmm. One is, maybe I misunderstood your question, but governments can buy almost anything on the market anyway. Whether they hire hackers or just purchase their work from commercial vendors or the highest bidders, this is what's ongoing. And it's one of the things I've been trying to do something about. My question to you is, do you think there are legal ways that we need to explore to end the proliferation of these kinds of technologies or to restrict them somehow? This is, I'm aware, a very controversial discussion, but one that I think is still worth compared to the status quo.
So the question was, you know, sort of legal and policy measures can we sort of bring to bear and say, if only we had a lawmaker in the room. but no, I think it's really tricky because I think that we can regulate sale of things because we already regulate sale of things.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, when you have people that are offering, like, here is a targeted surveillance solution and then that type of thing, I mean, there's all sorts of things that we already regulate from drugs to guns to, you know, chemicals and, you know, so, I mean, that doesn't, I think that'll, you know, some of the proposals there are very reasonable. I think it gets a lot murkier when we start contemplating, like, regulation of exploits because this is a far more nebulous thing, and you know, a lot of the people that sell this aren't actually set up as companies. They don't advertise a solution, and what they sell is they frequently sell software bugs. I mean, you don't even sell, like, you know, an actual weaponized thing. And so you know, how do you stop someone from selling a bug? Like, now there's a white market for bugs. Google will buy your bugs. Microsoft will buy your bugs. And so that part of things, I...
But there you can make the liability of companies who fail to patch higher. So at least you can give them to work harder.
I mean, I think that companies actually buying bugs and creating a white market for it is... I mean, this isn't so much a legal thing, but I mean, I think it's a really good thing because... I mean, Microsoft recently said that they would pay up to $100,000 for a mitigation bypass. And like, that's actually real money, right? Like, I mean, if we sort of looked at the prices that I sort of showed before, it's kind of a little bit on the low side, but it's sort of in the game, right? And so, I mean, I think that companies actually starting to do this actually creates, you know, as I said, the sort of the white market for this, the above board market for this type of thing, which I think is really good. Which I don't think entirely answers your question, but it's sort of things that companies
are
doing.
One challenge to that regulation is that Western countries buy these bugs too.
Yeah, yeah.
And so if we want to make a moral statement and say selling bugs for spying is bad, then it's hard to speak out of both sides of your mouth.
So actually one of my concerns with that is that say we regulate sale of these tools in a really good way, however that actually looks, right? Then one of my worries is, for instance, say Raytheon, which is one of the world's largest arms manufacturers, that also produces offensive digital technology. Are they really ever going to stop producing it and selling it to the US government? Or is there simply going to be some type of, I mean, as we've already seen, there are sort of secret courts interpreting secret laws. And so it makes, I think it would be good to have these laws on the books. I wonder if that then we would sort of get corollary secret laws which make it okay for very large governments to purchase. So like Raytheon selling stuff to the US government, can we actually regulate that? I mean, I don't know.
Has all this stuff been ad hoc for you to respond to it, or is it going to court as an expert witness? Have there been successful prosecutions on any of this?
No, I've never been an expert witness. Yeah. So. None of this constitutes legal advice. I'm not a lawyer.
The framework doesn't exist. No prosecution against either like an independent agency that's doing that.
Pardon?
There's no legal framework to do a prosecution.
Actually, I don't know. Richard, do you want to speak to? He was asking if there's any legal framework for prosecuting people for this now. Do you? I mean,
It depends. There are, on the EU level, which is what I know best, there are ad hoc sanctions to some countries, and they are about sales of repressive technologies, and so the question is how far you want to stretch that category.
So it's on the trade side.
It's on the trade side, and so I think that allows for a way to look at the transactional part, so who's paying for what and where is it going to be used. So for example, just like you have a weapon embargo, you know, as much as we would like to, weapons are still sold in the world, but there are circumstances where countries can no longer purchase weapons, and the same goes for tear gas. Or in the EU, we've also banned the sale and also transit through, basically, of, and this is a bit sinister, especially in this country, but there are medicines and also tools that are used for torture and death penalty. And the EU wants nothing to do with it, not to export it, but also not to transit. And so those are ways to be quite tweaked about certain transactions, certain technologies to certain countries.
Right. Good answer.
I was just wanted to bring up part of the mandate, at least the NSA, and I bet most state security services is also defense. And this is something that we have kind of forgotten about. And it's something that I think that political pressure could really help. Like something like the NSA has a massive trove of exploits. Now let's say they, instead of using these for tailored access, they use these, they submit these for fixes. The NSA's scale is so huge that would have quite a sizable impact on security in general. And then you raise the bar.
Didn't they deliberately destroy security?
No, they don't have them, but they find exploits to keep them. They use them for attacking.
No, I see.
But they say they're supposed to be doing defense as well.
There's a term for that, it's called NOVUS, nobody but us, which is, you know, we have this exploit, nobody else will, so it's fine, because we're the good guys.
Which is, fiction.
Well, yeah, I mean,
I'm sure there are lots of very interesting discussions that happen regarding which things should be used offensively and which things should be fixed, you know, sort of based on how likely you think they'd be found and, you know, like, but, yes.
Well, look, I mean, even in an ideal world, a reduction of this sort of thing, wouldn't it hit a wall of, like, necessary, proportionate, warranted, maybe justified use where, like, the need or desire for these things, even above board, will, like, maintain a, like, a market for it?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think that it's unlikely that people will simply stop using these sorts of technologies, and I think there are probably people that would argue that it is not desirable for these to be fully stopped because, you know, people will want... I mean, the most common arguments that you get are the Think of the Children ones, which is, you know, there's the four horsemen of the apocalypse, right? Which I think it's child pornographers, money launderers, drug dealers, and
defamation, piracy,
organized crime. But I mean, yeah, I mean, there's you know, all of these things, reasons why we have to have this technology. There's a lot of troubling things about its usage. I think part of the issue is that the discussion about the when, how, what, and where are very new, and so this type of technology is, as I mentioned before, it's actually reasonably scalable, it's reasonably deniable, and it's actually reasonably cheap. And so it used to be that, say, think about this as a thought exercise. Would you prefer that someone go through your bedroom or all of your online identity? Now, I would actually prefer that someone go through my bedroom, right? Because all they're gonna find is dirty clothes. However, all of my communications with everyone are on, you know, on my online life. Now, it used to be that, you know, in order to actually put a camera in someone's bedroom and wiretap their house, this was considered to be extremely invasive. And, you know, this person would have to be a serious person of interest. Probably like RICO case or better, like criminal conspiracy or something like that, right? Whereas this type of thing, which I actually feel is equivalent to going through someone's bedroom, as I said, it's scalable, it's cheap, it's deniable, and so its usage is becoming more and more widespread. And we haven't, I think, you sort of mentioned the necessary and proportionate kind of thing. I don't think we've had really good dialogues on that yet, which is why I think there's, I mean, hacking teams' marketing materials say, monitor up to hundreds of thousands of targets, which makes me kind of like, so I mean, I think, you know, like, if we actually find out how often this sort of thing is being used and against whom, then we can sort of decide as a society whether that is necessary and proportionate. So maybe we're like, well, if I found that, say, the government was hacking 5 people a year, I don't know, that sounds like reasonable. 50? Sure. Like 50,000? You know, like 100,000? And you start like, wait, I'm not sure that's, you know. And so, I mean, I think that these are the types of dialogues we really need to have.
Well, and the result.
And the result.
Yeah. So if you are, you know, paying for certain measures, like I'm taking an extreme example, but the Hadopi law in France to stop online piracy had a net result of costing approximately 12 million euros penalizing 6 individuals.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I think, I mean, one of the things with this stuff is that, I mean, it is cheaper than traditional methods of surveillance. Like, I'm not sure exactly what the cost. It would be interesting to know how much money is spent, because, like, I mean, how much this stuff costs is actually, again, you know, you have leaked slides from 2 years ago. You get some in the case of Egypt, it was found that, you know, they made this purchase order for 287,000 euros. What was really interesting is after we discovered it was being used in Mexico, a bunch of Mexican lawyers, and I don't know what a FOIA request is in Mexico, I can't remember, but it was the equivalent, and they discovered that the Mexican government had spent $15 million on Finfisher. So obviously they bought sort of the glad bag of tricks with the bells and whistles. So I mean, yeah, like our the public knowledge of what this costs is actually very fragmented, right, based on some very partial knowledge here and there. See?
Have you seen Marshall Hoffman's presentation from Trusty Hunt? No. She talked about the governance theories of what kinds of coercion are possible in terms of altering the design of the technology.
Okay.
And she suggested that the governance theory is that the coercion is, the legally permissible coercion is extremely broad and open-ended.
I'm not surprised. That's their interpretation?
She has some quotes about this. I think it would be interesting for more, and useful for more technology developers to see this.
Yeah.
Because we do see, you know, on Civilization Tech or wherever, someone says, I have my new encrypted communication platform. Or, you know, someone starts or continues to operate a communication-related business. And they say, oh, well, my security is really great, and I thought it through really well. Meanwhile, you have these court cases where you have these theories about, you know, what could the government secretly order them to change or divulge or secretly send to a particular user or whatever. And we don't have really reported court decisions that clarify this, but the government's theory, according to Marcia, is really quite broad.
Marcia is a lawyer and is capable of giving legal advice, so I actually do recommend that people watch this talk. Because it's certainly very fascinating, and I've had discussions with her about, you know, the sort of circumstances under which government can coerce crypto keys and that sort of thing, which she is infinitely more knowledgeable than I am. So it is actually very interesting that area, and there's like, you know, what sort of requests can the government make of providers in terms of redesign or, you know, coercion. One that I remember sort of from reading in the sort of technical press was about Project Chess. Remember that? That was Skype's. Skype was sort of a company based out of Luxembourg, and I think the CEO made a comment on the record in like 2005 where he said that, you know, Skype was functionally untappable, and it was like encrypted peer-to-peer traffic. So they actually literally did not know how to tap it, right? They were like, yeah, we just don't know how to comply with government requests and that sort of thing. And then it was leaked recently, and I don't remember exactly how there was certain regulations or investigative reporting or something like that, but there had actually been an internal project. They had actually been asked to figure out how they could actually tap Skype communications. And so they had an internal thing called Project Chess, which was apparently, you know, a project to actually alter their system so they actually could, you know, do tapping and that sort of thing. So, I mean, it does get interesting on what the government can ask you to do, right?
I don't know if this is Marshall's talk there or Chris Palmer's talk, but one of them suggested software updates to users as a, you know, one thing that the government could try to require. Like
malicious software updates?
Malicious software updates.
So, I mean, I think that's why the sort of whole idea of coercion-resistant design is important, right? Because the idea is that, you know, coercion is likely, as opposed to being one of those things that, like, oh, come on, what are the chances, you know? Okay. Xbox Live modules, you know, we've got to put it on there. World of Warcraft, you know, so, I mean, that's the... But, yes, I mean, I think we're good. Does anyone... I think that's it.
I'll...
That's it. And I'll...